Hey, this video, the next one, and maybe even the one after that, will be about IntelliJ IDEA Debugger. I know this topic is not tightly connected to Scala. After all, the debugger, at least the one we have in IntelliJ IDEA, works more or less the same no matter if you code in Scala, Java, or Kotlin, to name a few programming languages we support. That said, certain differences do exist. For example, when you debug implicit parameters, lazy values, or when you evaluate Scala collections. So, in this series, we will talk about the debugger and its features from the Scala point of view. This material is based on three talks by Egor Ushakov: IntelliJ IDEA Debugger Essentials, Debugger Advanced, and Debugger Professional. If you want to dive deeper into any feature we cover, I recommend checking out his talks. I will include the links in the description. For our code example, we'll use a program that reads data from a CSV file, prompts the user for input, modifies it, and writes it back to the file. Let's say we have a case class representing a movie protagonist with their first name, last name, and age. We have two protagonists, Jonas and Hannah Kahnwald, whose names and ages are stored in a CSV file. The program itself is straightforward. We read the file's content, deserialize it, ask the user for a number, and then call a function named updateAge. This function takes a protagonist and a number and returns a copy of the protagonist with the updated age. Next, we serialize both protagonist instances and write them back to the CSV file. Now, let's check whether the program behaves as described. Remember, the debugger isn't just for finding and fixing bugs. It's also useful for analyzing code that works correctly. Let's set a breakpoint on the first line of the main method and run the program in debug mode. I can do this by right-clicking the Run icon and selecting Debug, or by clicking the Bug icon in the top menu. But be careful, our program includes unit tests. Since I ran them earlier, IntelliJ IDEA will rerun the tests in debug mode if I click this icon now. That's not what we want. We want to debug the main method. So let's right-click the Run icon and select Debug. The program pauses at the breakpoint and the debugger view appears. Let's quickly review its buttons and panels. Here we can rerun the program from the start, stop it completely, resume execution from the current line. This will run the program to completion or until it hits the next breakpoint if one is set. The pause button is grayed out because the program is already paused. However, it's useful if the program runs for a long time. For instance, during computations or while waiting for a response from another system. In such cases, you can pause the program mid-execution, likely within a bottleneck. Next, we have three arrow buttons: step over, step into, and step out. These allow us to navigate the code line by line, stepping into function calls, executing them, and moving forward, or stepping out of the current function. There are also options like view breakpoints and mute breakpoints, along with other buttons hidden in this menu. We will cover those in later videos. One useful detail: each action has a keyboard shortcut, so you don't always need to click the buttons. You can also toggle the debugger view on and off with a shortcut. Below, we see the call stack in the frames window and the threads and variables window. The frames panel shows the current execution tries and lets us navigate up and down the call stack. Right now, we are simply in the main method of the update protagonist age object. Similarly, the threads and variables window shows only one reference, this, which is a self-reference to the update protagonist age object. Since the object has no fields, there's nothing else to display here. However, there is one more thing we can check: the path to the CSV file. To see it, hover over the protagonist file path field, its value will appear in a pop-up. Okay, let's move to the next line. I will click step over, the current line executes, and the highlight shifts to the next one. The file's contents are now read as a list of strings, and the variable lines refers to that list. We can see its value in both the threads and variables window and the editor, both at the line where the list was created and at the new current line. The next line deserializes these strings into two protagonist instances. We could step over again to see the result, but let's examine the process in detail. I want to click step into to enter the methods, but which one? This line contains two method calls, list map and protagonist from line, which handles the deserialization. IntelliJ IDEA prompts us to choose one. Let's step into from line by selecting it with the right arrow and pressing enter. The debugger takes us to the file protagonist Scala to the first line of the from line method. The method's parameter, line, and its value are displayed next to the method declaration and in the threads and variables window. The frames window now shows more entries too. We are inside from line called by map, and we can trace back to where map is invoked in the main method. For now, let's step out of from line by clicking step over, and step over again. We need to click three times because the list has two elements and the debugger wants to allow us to step into each call to from line. A quicker approach would be to click the target line and use the run to cursor action. On a Mac, the shortcut for it is option F9. Now we have exited the map method and the value protagonists holds a list of two protagonist instances. Since the debugger understands Scala collections and case classes, we can inspect them in the editor and the threads and variables window. We can even click explore elements to view the list as a table with each column representing a field, and we can sort by those fields. In the next line, we call ask for update. Clicking step over causes the program to pause by itself, and the console tab now shows a small icon with a down arrow. Let's switch to it. The ask for update method prints by how much should I update the age and waits for input. Let's enter 5 and press enter. This advances us one step and the value n is now set to 5. Next, we call map again, this time on the protagonists list, and inside it, we call update age to create new protagonist instances with updated ages. Let's proceed for now, but remember this code, we will return to it shortly. Finally, we serialize the updated protagonists using toLine. We can step into to quickly review its logic, then we write the updated string back to the CSV file. Let's open it. Jonas is now 24 and Hannah is 54. But wait, you may say, you didn't show us the file's original contents. How do we know anything has changed? And you'll be right. Let's address that. First, I will move the breakpoint from the first line to the one with update age. To do this, I can simply drag and drop it. Alternatively, I can create a new breakpoint by clicking the line number, or if the caret is already there, use the shortcut Command F8 on Mac. The same method removes a breakpoint. To copy a breakpoint, instead of moving it, I hold down the Ctrl key before dropping it on the new line. Notice this, when I set the breakpoint on the update age line, the debugger splits it into two, one for the entire line and one for the lambda, that is the actual update age call inside the map method. This lets us handle them separately, such as assigning different conditions. For example, let's pause at the lambda only if n equals 5. I will remove the other breakpoint, rerun the program in debug mode, and this time enter 2 when prompted. The program doesn't pause. Now Jonas is 26 and Hannah is 56. Let's run it again, but this time I will enter 5. Now the program pauses. Before resuming, let's modify the update age function to print how the protagonist's ages change. We will split the copy line into two steps and add a print line statement in the middle. Here's the catch. The program is already running. It's only paused, not stopped. The running code is bytecode, not the source code we are editing. So, logically, our changes shouldn't take effect. The code is already compiled. To modify the program, we should stop it, recompile, and rerun it. Right? Not quite. When I started editing update 8, a small pop-up appeared. It offers a hot swap of the code with the message "you changed code during the debug session, you can apply these changes without restarting. All modified files will be recompiled and reloaded." Let's go ahead and apply the changes. done. Now, if I click Step Into, the debugger will step into the new version of Update 8. When we resume execution, we will see the message in the Console tab confirming the protagonist's ages have changed. One more thing. While debugging adds some overhead compared to simply running the program, it's minimal these days. I would recommend using debug mode by default. Not only does it give you access to the hot swap feature, but it also provides valuable insights into how your program works. If you want to try it out, remember the shortcut Option-Shift-D on Mac. Alternatively, you can set a custom shortcut in Settings Keymap. And that's it for today. Thank you for watching. In the next video, we will talk about conditional breakpoints and logging. In the meantime, watch other videos on our channel, like and subscribe, read our blog, or chat with the development team on our Discord server. All the links to those resources can be found in the description. Happy developing!